Hello, Calculus 12 students. This is Mr. Yoon, and in this video tutorial, I'll be covering lesson number one from chapter number seven. And this lesson is titled Motion Along a Straight Line. So basically, in this video tutorial, we'll be going over a lot of these physics application problems, and we'll be trying to solve these problems using the antiderivative. All right, so let's jump into a review problem. So back in chapter number five, I believe we did take a look at a few of these physics application word problems, and often we were given some kind of a position function. And when we're dealing with a position function, the letter that we're going to be the letter that will be used will be the letter S of t. Okay, so we have this position function of a particle, and the function is given by S of t equals to t negative t cubed plus 4.5 t squared, and it's graphed below. And for this very first review problem, I want to find the displacement and the distance traveled when the particle is between the interval 0 to 4 seconds. Okay, so here's my graph, and I'm going to label the sides here. So my y-axis is going to be s of t because that's the position, and my x-axis should be time. Okay, so this graph right here shows the position of the particle at any given time. Now, if I want to find displacement, all right, so I will be using the symbol d hat. This represents displacement, and the physics definition for displacement is basically a change in position. Okay, and anytime we have a change in position or change in anything, that basically means we're looking at the final position, and we will subtract that from the initial position. Okay, so anytime we have a change in anything, it's always going to be the final amount minus the beginning amount. And since we're dealing with a position function, basically, the symbol that's used for a position function is s. So this will be s of maybe s of b minus s of a. Okay, and basically, b represents the time, the final time, and a represents the initial time. Okay, and if I go back to my the time interval that's given to me, basically, I will be starting at a final time of s of 4. So this will be s of 4 here minus my initial time, which will be 0. So that's going to be s of 0. So my displacement is pretty much given by this formula right here, which is S of 4 minus S of 0. Now you got to ask yourself, what does S of 4 mean? Basically that's asking you, if time is 4, what is your position? Okay, well, if this is my time of 4, if I go straight up, then I will have a position of 8. Okay, and then what about S of 0? So basically that means when you're at a time of 0, what is your position? So when you're at a time of 0, you have a position of 0. Okay, so this is simply going to be 8 minus 0, which equals to 8. Okay, so my displacement is going to be 8. Now don't worry about the units, we'll just use 8 for the time being, but that's how you find displacement. All right, so I'm just going to erase this, and then we'll continue on with the distance problem. Okay, for the second part of the problem, I need to find the distance traveled by the particle. So if I'm trying to find distance, I'll use the letter d. Now d is the scalar, so I don't need a hat there. And all I have to do in terms of finding my distances is that I need to evaluate the position when we're at 0. Sorry, when we're at a time of 0. And we're at a time of 4, and see how far the particle has traveled. Now, one interesting point that you should look at is this maximum point right here, this max. And you get a maximum when you have a time value of 3. Okay, so when you reach a time value of 3 seconds, roughly if you do use your graphing calculator, you'll have a maximum height of 13.5. So what that basically means is, if you start at a time of 0 seconds, and if you go all the way up to 3 seconds, you travel the total distance of 13.5 meters. Okay, but we want to go from 0 to 4 seconds, right? So here's 4 seconds. If I go straight up from 4 seconds, this has a height of 8. Now ask yourself, what is this difference right here, or that distance right there? Well, that's simply going to be 5.5. All right, so if you take this 8, and if you add 5.5, you get 13.5. Okay, so the total distance traveled from 0 to 4 seconds is basically going from 0 to 3, which is 13.5, and then you add another 5.5. So the total distance is going to be 13.5 plus 5.5, and that gives you a grand total of 19. Now, this 13.5, that's the distance traveled from 0, when t is between 0 and 3. And this 5.5, that's the distance traveled when you're between 3 and 4 seconds. Okay, so that's how you get the total distance traveled by looking at the graph. Okay, so now that we've kind of reviewed some basic physics problems, so what we're going to do is we're going to be trying to solve this exact same question, but instead of using the graph, this S of t function, we're going to be looking at using the antiderivative. Okay, so let's start off with a definition for this lesson here. And the first definition I want to give you is displacement. So yes, displacement is a net change in position, right? So when I say a net change in position, I mean like your final position minus your initial position, all right? So that's what we mean by a net change in position. Now, let me just kind of zoom in right here. The physics definition for displacement, if you're going from time t equals to a to time t equals to b, is given by the integral of v of t dt. And if we use the fundamental theorem of calculus, we know that the antiderivative of velocity is position. So this is going to be s of b minus s of a. So if I use the fundamental theorem of calculus, if I go ahead and expand v of t, the antiderivative of v of t is its position. So this is your final position, and this is your initial position. Okay, so if I want to find the displacement of any function, I just take the antiderivative of its velocity function. Okay, and another definition that we need to know is this distance formula. So if I want to find the total distance traveled by the object from initial time t equals to a to t equals to b, that's given by this formula, which is the integral from a to b of the absolute value of v of t dt. Okay, so those are two new definitions that we're going to be using throughout this lesson in order to find the displacement as well as the total distance. Okay, now let's go ahead and apply this to a new problem here. Well, actually, not a new problem, the same problem, but this time instead of giving you the position function as I did back in this, sorry, if I go back up here, back in this first example, I gave you the position function, right? So instead of giving you the position function, let me give you the velocity function, right? So if I want to find the velocity, all I have to do is I take the derivative of my position function and I'll get this right here. So just remember, in my very first example, my position function was s of t equals to negative t cubed plus 4.5 t squared. Okay, so this was my original question, and if I take the derivative of s of t, I get this v of t function right there. Okay, so basically, if I'm given v of t, I want to go ahead and I want to find the corresponding displacement and the corresponding total distance between time equals to 0 and 4. Okay, so if I graph this v of t guy right there, I get this image over here. Okay, so let's go ahead and solve this using my new definition now. So if I want to find displacement, I know displacement is denoted by d hat, and my new definition of displacement is the integral from a to b of v of t times d of t. And if I go ahead and expand this using the fundamental theorem of calculus, I know this will be s of b minus s of a, which is your final position minus your initial position. Okay, so I want to go from a value of 0, so this is going to be 0, all the way up to a value of 4, so my upper bound is 4 and my lower bound is 0. This is my displacement. And what is my v of t function? Well, that's going to be bracket negative 3t squared plus 9t close bracket dt. And all I have to do now is I need to evaluate this integral, and then I would have my answer. Now, I already know what my answer is. It should be 8, right? Because when I found my displacement in my very first question here, I know that displacement was 8, right? So hopefully we'll get the same answer of 8. Okay, so let's go ahead and evaluate this integral problem now. Okay, so let's take a look here. If I go ahead and find the antiderivative of this expression right here, that's going to be negative t cubed plus 4.5 t squared. And since I've taken the antiderivative, I'm going to put this in brackets, and I will evaluate this from 0 to 4. Okay. The good news is I have a 0 here, so that takes care of half the calculations here. So in order to finish this problem off, is I need to put this 4 into every single t value and then evaluate that. So this is going to be, if I plug in 4 into this negative t cubed here, I'm going to get negative 64. And if I plug in 4 into this t value there, I will get plus 72, and that gives me a value of 8. Now, going back to my little graph right here, basically what that means is, let's just say my time value here is 4 and the graph kept on going like that. Basically, I just found that the area right here, this yellow part and this blue part, sorry, this blue part right here, if I went ahead and found the net area between the yellow part and the blue part, then that would give me a total of 8. So my displacement is 8 units in this problem. Okay, great. Let's move on to the next one here. The next problem is asking for the total distance traveled. So I know that my total distance traveled is given by this new formula, which is the antiderivative or the integral from A to B of the absolute value of V of t times d of t. Okay. Now, I know if I went ahead and plugged in my values here, I know I'm going from a lower bound of 0 and upper bound of 4, and the absolute value, this would be negative 3t squared plus 9t, close the bracket, times dt. Okay, so there it is. This is how I would insert this into my formula, and if you went to your graphing calculator directly, you can get an answer of 19 pretty quickly just by plugging the numbers into your calculator. But what I want to do here is I want to set this up into two different integrals, because if I take a look at my graph right here, between this is my absolute value function from 0 to about 4 seconds here. 4 seconds is about here, so I'm looking about something like that. And I want to find this total area here, this area highlighted in blue. So that area and this area right here. Now, if I went ahead and separate this into separate integrals right here, I know I'm starting from 0. I know this value right here is 3, and this value here is going to be 4. So this 0, this 3, and that 4, those are some of my key x coordinates there. And if I went ahead and separated this into different parts, this would be distance equals to the integral from 0 to 3. Now, from 0 to 3, that's just this black area right here. And what equation represents that region of the graph? Well, that's simply going to be negative 3t squared plus 9t and then dt. All right, now if I went ahead and extended this, so if this is going to be 3, then I know that this lower bound has to be 3 as well, right? That's one of the integral properties. And then I finish off at a value of 4, so I'll put a 4 here on my upper bound. Now the question is, this part right here that I'm kind of shading right now in this green color, I mean, what is the equation? I mean, let me just delete all this. I mean, basically I want to know, what is the equation of this yellow line right there? Okay, so notice that this yellow line, this part has been reflected across the x-axis. So if I go to my previous graph right here, if I look at this purple part right here, this purple part used to be below the x-axis, and if I take the absolute value of that, then that part has been reflected across the x-axis. Now, in order to write the equation for that, all we have to do is apply a constant from pre-calculus 12, and that is, if you are reflected across the x-axis there, then basically whenever you have a variable, you want to multiply that with a negative sign. So this expression right here that I'm highlighting in yellow, you would multiply that by a negative sign, and that's the same thing with a 9t. So that's how you show a reflection in the x-axis, by multiplying everything by a negative sign, and that would be 3t squared minus 9t brackets dt. Okay, and there it is. And then you would go ahead and you would evaluate this integral. All right, so this is how you would solve this problem if you weren't given a graphing calculator. So when you're not given a graphing calculator, the work that you have to do is a little bit longer. So I'm gonna go ahead and pause the video here, and I'll give you the full detailed solution. Okay, so Basically, during that time out there, I basically went ahead and evaluated the antiderivative and also evaluated the upper and lower bounds. And if you do all that, you should get a final answer of 19, which does indeed match the answer that we had when we first started this problem. Okay. And just on a side note here, if you had access to a graphing calculator, what you could also do is you can just plug this whole expression right here into your graphing calculator, and your graphing calculator will also give you a final answer of 19. So if I just bring up my graphing calculator right now, if I went ahead and want to put this integral into my graphing calculator, you need to activate this FNINT option, and you find that option by simply going to your math option, hitting math, and going down to option number 9. Option number 9 will give you the FININT option. And once you have that, you want to put in the absolute value, or put this whole absolute value function into your expression here. You need to integrate with respect to x. This is your lower bound of 0, and this is your upper bound of 4. And in order to find your absolute value function, all you have to do is you hit math again, go over to NUM, which is 1 over, and your absolute value is that very first option there, okay? So you can definitely solve these kind of problems using your graphing calculator as well. Okay, well, let's move on to the next problem. Make sure you kind of pause the video and make sure that you are able to get this expression below here, because it's just basically plugging the numbers into your antiderivative. Okay, let's go on to a few more definitions here. Some of the other problems that we study in this lesson have to do with finding the final position of an object. And this concept pretty much comes from the definition of displacement. Remember, displacement, now you don't have to copy this down, you just need to kind of pay attention here. Displacement is basically your final position minus your initial position, right? And what we want to do is we want to solve for final position, right? So all we're going to do is we're going to take this initial position and we're going to bring that to the other side. Okay, so if I do that, that's going to be initial position plus your displacement equals to your final position, right? So this is what we're going to be, this is another formula that we're going to be looking at for the next few problems in this lesson. So final position is equal to your initial position plus your displacement. Okay, and now, so if I just erase all that, that's pretty much this formula right here. Your final position is your initial position plus your displacement. Now, we already have some notation built in for your final position. Final position is going to be S sub b, right? This is the notation that we used when we first started this lesson here, S sub b. So that means your initial position will be S of a. And what's your new definition of displacement? Well, displacement is simply the integral from a to b of v of t dt. Okay, so this is a brand new formula that we're going to be using in order to find the final position when we have these physics-related word problems. Okay, and we also have this is very if we want to find the final velocity, finding the final velocity is very similar to how we find the final position. All right, so final velocity is also given by this formula right here, where you have your initial velocity plus the antiderivative of acceleration, which is your change in velocity. Okay, so we're not going to worry so much about the velocity questions, but we will be using the final position formula quite a bit to finish off the questions in this lesson. All right, let's take a look at an example problem right here. Let me just zoom out so we get the full word problem here. Okay, so in this kind of a problem, I have another particle and it moves along a straight line, and its velocity function is given by v of t equals to 2t plus 3. The position of the particle is 2 at t equals to 1. Okay, so let me, instead of highlighting that in yellow, let me highlight this part in blue here, because this is actually a pretty important piece of information right there. That blue part is pretty much saying that the position at time equals to 2 sec, sorry, the position will be 2 when time equals to 1. So that means when s is being evaluated at time value 1, we have a value of 2 for the position. So this is really your initial. This is your initial position right here. Okay. And then the question is asking, find the position function of the particle under these conditions. So pretty much we're trying to find the final position right here. All right. So when we're trying to find a position function under these conditions, we're generally trying to find the final position here. Okay, so how do we do this? Well, let's use our new formula for final position, which is going to be S of B equals to S of A plus the integral from A to B of V of T dt. Okay, now what is our initial time right here? Well, this is going to be S of 1, right? Because 1 is our initial time right here, S of 1. Delete that. So let me highlight this in blue here. So when t equals to 1, that's our initial time there. And we're not given an exact value for our final time. So instead of saying b, what we're going to do is we're going to replace b with t because we want to find the final position at any given time after our initial time of 1. Okay, so since we're trying to find the general final position function, we can substitute b with t. So then this will be the integral from 1 to t. Sorry, maybe I'll delete this here and we'll put a t right there. Okay, so we're trying to find the final position, and since we're not given a final time value for b, we'll just use t as a general time indicating that we can go on forever, but we can stop at any given time. And what is our velocity function? Where our velocity function is 2t plus 3 times d of t. And then all we have to do now is we just need to evaluate this. Well, what is S of 1? Well, S of 1 is our initial position, and S of 1 is going to be 2. So this will be 2 plus the integral from 1 to t of bracket 2t plus 3 dt. Okay. Now, if I want to go ahead and evaluate this integral right here, let me just erase this here. If I want to find the antiderivative of 2t plus 3, that's going to be bracket t squared plus 3t, and I'm going to evaluate this from 1 to t. Okay, so let's go ahead and find this final position function here. I need to insert this t for every single t, and if I do that, I get the same thing, right? That's going to be t squared plus 3t. And then if I go ahead and evaluate this 1, I need to plug in a 1 for my t values now. So this is going to be a close to bracket there, minus 1 plus 3, close the bracket. And if I go ahead and now simplify the final product here, or the final outcome here, I'll get t cubed plus 3t. This part right here will be 4, and this will be 2. So 2 minus 4 is going to be negative 2. So there it is. This is my position function for the problem given my current conditions. Okay, so that's how we do a final position problem there. Let's try one more here. Now, for this example, I will state that please use a graphing calculator to evaluate the following. Okay, so I'm given my velocity function, and I'm also given this initial condition here. So this is the first piece of information that's kind of given. So we'll call this the initial position because that's the first position that's given to me. And I want to find S of 2, so, and S of 2, that will be my final position. Okay. And one of the reasons why I can declare this to be the final position is because this net value 2 is bigger than this negative 1. So that's another good indicator that S of 2 is my final position. Okay. So let's go ahead and find the final position by writing out our formula. So this is going to be S of B equals to S of A plus the integral from A to B of V of T times dt. Okay. And all we have to do now is we need to evaluate this expression right here. What's the value of b? Well, the value of b is going to be 2. So this will be S of 2 equals to S of, well, what's the value of a? Well, the value of a is going to be negative 1. So this will be negative 1 plus the integral from negative 1 to 2. And v of t is e to the power of negative t squared times d of t. Okay. And then before we can use our graphing calculator to evaluate this, S of 2 is going to be, well, S of 2 is going to be 2, so this will be 2 plus the integral from negative 1 to 2 of e to the power of negative t squared times d of t. All right, so what we do now is now we just go to our graphing calculator and evaluate this expression right here. and then we simply add 2 to that, and that will be our final answer. So I'm going to pause the video here, and I'll bring out my graphing calculator in a sec. Okay, so if I bring out my calculator right here, if I put let me just kind of move this across now. Okay, so if I go ahead and put that red express this sorry the everything that's in this red box, I'll highlight this part in yellow here. If I put that expression into my graphing calculator, this is what you should have. You should have FININT of e to the power of negative x squared, and you want to integrate with respect to x, and your lower boundary will be -1, 2, and you'll get 1.6289. But then you also have to add this initial condition of 2, right? So you got to add that 2 there. So this will give you a final answer of 3.63 using your graphing calculator. Okay. All right. Let's move on to another problem now. So a very similar problem. A particle moves along the s-axis, and we were given this velocity function for t is time is greater or equal to 0. And the position of the particle is 2 at time t equals to 0. So that's another initial condition here. So s of 0 is going to be 2. So this is another initial condition right here, or your initial position right here. Okay. And then I want to find the position of the particle at a time value of t equals to 4. So basically, we're being asked to find your final position, which is the same thing as we want to find what s of 4 is equal to. All right, so in order to start this problem off, once again, we go back to our new definition of final position, which is s of b equals to s of a plus the integral from a to b of v of t dt, right? So once again, this is your final position, this is your initial position, and this is your displacement. All right, let's erase all that. And so this is going to be s of 4 equals to s of 0 from the integral from 0 to 4, and your new velocity function, I'll put this in brackets here, this is e to the sine t minus 1, close bracket, dt. Okay, so let's go ahead right now, let's go to our graphing calculator and let's evaluate this. Once we evaluate that using our graphing calculator, we can add that to our initial position. Our initial position in this case will be 2, so 2 plus all of that will give us our final answer. So I'm going to pause the video one more time and let's go to our graphing calculators and let's just see if we can get the final answer here. All right, welcome back. And if I go to my graphing calculator and if I put this in, I should get something like this. So this e to the sine t minus 1 from 0 to 4, just put this into your graphing calculator like this, e to the power of sine x, close two brackets, -1, integrate with respect to x from 0 to 4, and you should get 2.796. So if you get 2.796 and add 2, because that's your initial condition, your final answer after adding the initial condition should be 4.796, and that's your final answer for that problem. Okay, let's go ahead and move on to the very last problem, which is another calculator-based question here. In this question, we're given the velocity function again. We're going from 0 to 2 pi, so make sure you are in radian mode here because this is 2 pi. And we're also given another initial condition. The position of the particle is 2 at time t equals to 0. So this is going to be my initial position right here. This is going to be s of 0 equals to 2 again. Okay. And this right here, this graph is my velocity graph. It's not my position graph, it's my velocity graph. And if you went ahead and put this into your graphing calculator, one x-intercept that you can calculate right away is this value right here, and that's going to be 3.14159, which is the value of pi, right? This is going to be 2 pi, and this value here is going to be 0. Okay, so let's go ahead and analyze this problem now that we kind of analyzed the original graph here, which is your velocity function. Question 1 states, at what time intervals does the particle change direction? Well, if I go back to my graph here, this yellow line means the particle is going away, and now it's slowing down, but still going away. Once we reach this x-intercept, that means we're no longer moving because our velocity is 0. And then if I go below the x-axis, that means I'm actually going backwards. So this right here is the time where actually I change direction because I'm going forward and then go backwards. So I change directions at time equals to 3.14159, and the reasoning is because your velocity function goes from being positive, meaning above the x-axis, to being negative, which is below the x-axis, which indicates you are changing directions. You're going forward, then you stop, and you go backwards, all in that one, all in that you do all that pretty quickly, and it's very instantaneous. So that's why the time will be 3.14159. Okay, let's move on to the next question here. Next question is asking for the position of the particle at time t equals to 3. So basically, they're asking you for what is s of 3, and this is pretty much your final position. Right, so they want to know what your final position is. All right, so when we're looking for a final position, that's going to be s of b equals to s of a plus the integral from a to b of v of t times d of t. All right, so this is going to be s of 3 here. And what is our initial condition here, s of a? Well, if I go back to the original problem, my initial condition is right here, s of 0 equals to 2. So this is the same thing as s of 0. And now I'm integrating from 0 to 3. And my velocity function is going to be bracket, it's going to be 3 e to the sine t minus 3 times dt. Okay, and if we go ahead and evaluate this, s of 0 is going to be 2, right? And if I add that to the integral, this integral sign right here, if you do it in your graphing calculator, that's roughly going to be about 9.2. So 2 plus 9.2 is going to be 11.2. So roughly your answer should be 11.2. Okay, so that's the position of the function at time t equals to 3. All right, next question. I want to find the displacement now. And the displacement is actually the displacement is, well, we've already done this, but let me just rewrite the definition of displacement already. The displacement is the integral from a to b of v of t times d of t. In this case, I'm going from time t equals to 0 to time t equals to pi. So this is 0 to pi. And my function is going to be 3e to the sine t minus 3 times d of t. And if I go ahead and go to my calculator, I will get an answer of 9.20. Okay, so that is my displacement right there. Okay, let's move on to the total distance now. And if I want to find the total distance, this is pretty much the integral from t equals to 0 to t equals to pi again. So this is going to be 0 to pi. And now I need the absolute value of my velocity function, absolute value times d of t. Okay, and that's going to be the integral from 0 to pi, absolute value of 3e to the sine t minus 3, close that vertical line, d of t. And if you go to your graphing calculator and evaluate all of this, you will get a final answer of 9.20, which is the exact same answer as the displacement. And hopefully this makes sense, because if you go back to your original graph here, and if you go ahead and just erase this, erase that, time t equals to 0 to time t equals to 3 is right about here. So you're actually just finding the area under the curve between 0 and 3. And since we're not going below the x-axis, your displacement and your total distance should be the same. All right, let's move on to the next question here. Next question is asking for the average acceleration of the particle over the time interval between t equals to 1 and t equals to 4. Average acceleration, this is pretty much, whenever you see the word average, this is pretty much your slope of the secant line. All right, so slope of the secant line is kind of like your rise over run, or y2 minus y1 over x2 minus x1. So we're just finding the slope of the secant line from time t is greater than 1 to a time value of less than 4. So if I go back to my original graph here, let me just kind of erase all this now. If I look at my graph very carefully here, from if I go from a value of t equals to 1, which is right here, this is time t equals to 1, which is that value right there, and here's a value of 4, t equals to 4, which is right here. So I want to find this slope right here of that red line. Okay, so that slope has a negative value, right? Sorry, this slope is negative because we're going down the hill, and we just want to find the numerical value of that slope. Okay, so this is simply like a grade 10 level problem now. It's just that our notation is a little bit different now. So our average acceleration is going to be y2. Now, what's y2? y2 is pretty much your velocity function being evaluated at the value of 4. This is v of 4 minus the velocity at time t equals to 1, which is v of 1, all divided by 4 minus 1. And once again, if I want to evaluate v of 4 and v of 1, we just go back to our original function and we evaluate v of 4 and v of 1. Okay. Now I've already done that in my calculator already, so I know v of 4 is going to be negative 1.593 minus v of 1, which is 3.9593, all divided by 4 minus 1. If you do the math there, you get negative 1.85. All right, and I won't include any units right now, but let's just take this negative 1.85 at face value. Okay, let's move on to the final problem now. All right, for this very last question, this last question does require a little bit of work because for the last question, we want to find out at what time does the particle reach the farthest point from the origin. Okay, and we want to show some calculations to support your answer. So at what times is the particle farthest from the origin? Okay, well, first of all, let's take a look at our initial position to start off. If you recall, our initial position that was given to us at the beginning of the problem was s of 0, which is 2. Okay, so we know our initial position is s of 0, which equals to 2. So what that means is that when we have a time value of 0, we are actually 2 units away from the origin. Now, does this time value represent the farthest distance that we're from the origin? Maybe, or maybe it's not. Okay, so what we can also do is we can also look at the final position. Okay, so once we're done this entire problem, where is our position once we've kind of reached the final time value? Now, if I go back to my original question, this kind of graph, if I erase all of this now, just erase all of that. If I look at the values for my time, I know that my final time here is going to be 2 pi. So when I reach a time value of 2 pi, another good question that I can ask myself is what is the final position when t equals to 2 pi? Okay, so that's considered my final position when t equals to 2 pi. So let's go ahead and calculate our final position when time equals to 2 pi. And in order to do that, that's pretty much asking us, what is my position when time equals to 2 pi, right? What's my final position when time equals to 2 pi? Well, that's simply going to be my initial position, s of 0, plus my displacement from 0 to 2 pi. This is just the definition of this is just the definition of the final position of v of t times d of t. Now, what is v of t times d of t? Let me just erase that. That's simply going to be this is going to be 3 e to the sine t minus 3, close that bracket of d of t. So let's go ahead and evaluate this expression. And this is going to be 2 plus. Now, if I go to my calculator and if I put this into my calculator right here, and I've done that already on the side here, I get a value of about 5.015. And if I add that all together, I get 7.015. So basically, the 7.0105, what that means is that's my distance away from the origin when time equals to 2 pi, which is definitely bigger than this value of 2. So far, when I'm looking for the time value where the particle reaches the farthest point from the origin, this 7.015 would be a good answer because it's definitely bigger than the value of 2, which is my initial position. Okay. Now, another time value that you can consider for this problem after doing the initial position and the final position is if you go back to your graph right here, you could also find the time value where you're actually changing position, which is right here. So this has a time value of 3.14159, and that's where you're changing positions, right? So we can find out how far from the origin are you going, because from here to here, this yellow line, this yellow part of the graph, that means you're moving to the right? So this blue part means you're moving to the right, but you're going very fast, and then you're still moving to the right, but then the purple part means you're slowing down. So if we kind of look at this whole this velocity right there, because this is a v of t function, we can find out how far you moved from the origin once you reach a t value of 3.1459, because at that time value, this is where you stop, right? And you change positions. So let's just find out how far from the origin you moved once you reach the time value of 3.14159 seconds. Now, in order to do that, all I have to do is I need to evaluate. Sorry, I need to evaluate the final position when we're at a time value of 3.14159, which is the same thing as taking your initial position and then your displacement from 0 to 3.14159 of bracket 3e to the sine t minus 3 dt. So this expression right here, I'm just finding out what my final position would be after I traveled a total of 3.1459 seconds, because once I traveled for 3.1459 seconds, that indicates the part of the graph where I'm moving forward in the right direction. So let's see how far I traveled away from the origin. So S of 0, that's going to be 2. And this part right here, if you put this into your graphing calculator, which I've done already, that gives you a value of 9.201, and if you add that together, that's going to be 11.2, which is bigger than the 7.05, right? It's definitely bigger. So the final question is, at what time is the particle farthest from the origin? Well, the time value would be 3.14159, because that gives us a distance of 11.2 away from the origin. Okay, so that concludes this video tutorial. I've gone over ma the majority of the problems, and feel free to ask me questions in class. Okay, thank you very much, and bye.